Finally, my name's Tanya. I work for Cisco. I'm not here to disagree with anything, but I've always had a lot of people, especially Muslims, well, not a lot of people, just Muslims, always telling me, because you're a Catholic, you're going to go to Jahannam, but we're Muslims, you need to convert and you will go to heaven. According to me, I'm a good Catholic. I try to be a good Catholic. I don't intentionally commit sin. But does that mean because I'm a Catholic, I'm going to go to hell, and if I'm a Muslim, I'm going to go to heaven?
Sister asked a question that many of her Muslim friends say, because she's a Catholic, because she's a Christian, she will go to hell. That is it true that because she's a Christian, you'll go to hell? Sister, according to me, if you're a true Christian, if you truly follow the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, inshallah, you shall go to Jannah. Okay. But, if you truly follow the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, seek ye the truth and the truth shall free you. Correct? Now, what you are following, I don't know. Are you following your church or are you following Jesus Christ, peace be upon him? If you are following your church, the chances of going to Jahannam is very high. If you are following Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, inshallah, inshallah, you shall go to Jannah. Now, if you read the Bible, there are sayings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. I don't know how much you are well versed with the Bible. Now, all the sayings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, are in red letter. Are in red letter. Yeah. Sister, do you believe Jesus to be God?
Well, I'm a bit confused about that, so I'm not going to get into that.
No, I'm asking yes or no.
Well,
confused God.
No, it's not confusion, but I don't want to answer something I don't know. And it's not funny.
I'm not saying you know or not. Sister, I'm not saying you know or not. What do you believe, I'm asking?
No, I do believe he's God. Yes,
yes,
I
that's
do.
It. I'm not saying yes. What you know. You may not I be do. Able to prove it.
Yeah,
fine.
I do.
Sister, I'll tell you one thing. Islam is the only non-Christian faith which makes it an article of faith to believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. No Muslim is a Muslim if he does not believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. We believe that he was one of the mightiest messengers of God. We believe that he was born miraculously without any main intervention. We believe that he was the Messiah, translated Christ. Yes. We believe that he gave life to the dead with God's permission. We believe that he healed those born blind lepers with God's permission. The Christians and the Muslims, we are going together. But one may ask, where is the parting of ways? The parting of ways is, sister, that most of the Christians, almost all, they believe that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is Almighty God. They believe he claimed divinity. In fact, if you read the Bible, there is not a single unequivocal statement. There is not a single unambiguous statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, or where he says worship me. Sister, if you can point out a single unequivocal statement, a single unambiguous statement anywhere from the Bible in which Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, or where he says worship me, I am ready to accept Christianity today. In fact, if you read the Bible,
I'm not talking about you accepting
I'll come
it
to
or not.
I'm
I
not.
I got my answer already.
I'm giving you, yes.
I got my answer.
You got half the answer. I'm giving the complete answer,
okay.
Inshallah.
You can go ahead.
You got half the answer.
Okay.
I told you that if you're a true Christian, you shall go to Jannah.
Yes.
You don't know what a true Christian is. I'm giving you information what true Christian is.
Okay.
If you read the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 28, my Father is greater than I. Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse number 29, my Father is greater than all. Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 12, verse number 28, I cast out devils with the Spirit of God. Gospel of Luke, chapter number 11, verse number 20, I with the finger of God cast out devils. Gospel of John, chapter number 5, verse number 30, I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just. For I seek not my will, but the will of my Father. Anyone who says, I seek not my will, but the will of Almighty God, is a Muslim. So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, submitted his will to God. He was a Muslim. He never said he was God. It's clearly mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verse number 24. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says that the words that you hear are not mine, but my Father's who has sent me. And it's clearly mentioned in the book of Acts, chapter number 2, verse number 22. Ye men of Israel, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God amongst you by wonders and miracles and signs which God did by him, and you are witness to it. So Jesus Christ is a man approved of God amongst you by wonders and miracles and signs which God did by him, and you are witness to it. So from the Bible we come to know that Jesus Christ was one of the most beloved messengers of Almighty God. We love him, we respect him. Do we follow his teachings? If you compare what Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said in the Bible, I told that yesterday, that we Muslims, we follow more of the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Jesus Christ, according to the Gospel of Luke, he was circumcised on the eighth day. We Muslims are circumcised, most of the Christians aren't. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, you have to follow each and every law. Gospel of Matthew chapter 5, verse number 17. Everything of the Old Testament, you can't break one law or dot or a tittle. As I mentioned in my speech, it's mentioned in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse number 8. In the book of Isaiah chapter 65, verse 2 to 5. And the book of Leviticus chapter number 11, verse number 7 to 8. That you should not have pork. We Muslims don't have pork, but most of the Christians have pork. It's mentioned in the book of Ephesians, chapter 5, verse number 18. Book of Proverbs, chapter 20, verse number 1. You should not have alcohol. Muslims don't have alcohol, but Christians have alcohol. So if Christian means a person who follows the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, then we Muslims are more Christian than the Christians themselves. So if you become a true Christian and truly follow the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 7, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter shall not come. For if I go, shall I send him? It's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 12 to 14. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, I have many things to say unto you, but he cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself. All that here shall he speak. He shall glorify me. Verbatim quotation from the Bible, King James Version. So Jesus Christ is prophesying about the coming of the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. If you're a true Christian, if you truly believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, you have to believe in the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So if you're a true Christian, you'll believe in Prophet Muhammad and inshallah you shall go to Jannah. Hope that answers the question, sister.
Thank you.
I just want to read this one first before I start. The First Amendment. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press, or the right of people peacefully to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. Hi, this is Faisal Fahim. I am an American Bangladeshi Sunni Muslim. I am an American Bangladeshi Sunni Muslim. And I am a New Yorker. I live in New York City. And I just want to talk to Mr. Donald Trump and also Sir Vladimir Putin, the President of Russia and the President of United States of America. I don't really think any Muslim has ever done this thing, but it's just, I live in America. We have freedom of speech and freedom of religion. And I'm an American Muslim. And, we exercise our freedom of everything. And I just want to tell Mr. Donald Trump and also Mr. Vladimir Putin, the President of Russia and USA, about basically the basics of Islam, what we basically believe. Just to give you an idea about it, it's just, nobody can convert anyone. We know we could just tell people what we believe and share our faith. Sharing is caring, and basically that's it, and about Sir Donald Trump, the current president of the United States of America. I wasn't really for you. I did not support you. I actually supported the Democrats, Hillary Clinton. And the reason was basically, the media and the YouTube, and I saw a lot of negative video of you, regarding the Muslims. I hope things will change, and I heard your last speech, and you were talking about unity and all religions. So I hope you're gonna be a better president for United States of America. So congratulations. So, and I think people in America should stop protesting and riots and all those things they're doing. I think they should stop it. And even Hillary Clinton has accepted you as the president. So So all Americans should be united, regardless of race or religion, and we should all accept you as the President of the United States of America. So congratulations again to Mr. Donald Trump for becoming the President, and I hope you are going to be the right leader, and you're going to lead the country to do good things. And I also hope Mr. Vladimir Putin and Mr. Donald Trump, the great presidents of United States of America and Russia, you're going to be, you know, leading the world for basically work together and create a better world for all of humanity. That's what I wish, and that's what I hope from both of you, that you are great, and you're the presidents of the greatest countries in the world, you know. And so I hope you guys can lead the world to a better place and make this world a better place for all of humanity, including Jews, Muslims, Christians, Hindus, atheists, everybody. And I hope you get along also, Russia and America, I think they should become friends. There's nothing wrong with that. It's a great thing, I think. And yeah, so I'm not really a politician, like I already said. Yeah, I supported Hillary Clinton, but now Donald Trump is the president, so all Americans should accept him. So congratulations to Mr. Donald Trump. Now coming back to the religion, okay? So I just really hope Mr. Donald Trump and Mr. Vladimir Putin, I hope both of you will watch my video. I just wanted to tell you a brief about what we really believe and what Islam actually is. So okay, the first thing is basically, in order for anyone to understand Islam, you have to know what is the concept of God and what is the definition of God and also the definition of the devil. In Islam, we believe there is only one God worthy of worship. There is no other God besides Him, and God has no gender, and God has no partner, no mother, father, daughter, sister, wife, nothing. And you know, like before Moses, Jesus, Muhammad, before, you know, the Christians believe in the Holy Spirit. So before everything, you know, there was before everything, there was nothing, and but there was only one thing, and that was God, the Creator. And then the Creator, you know, if you believe in the Holy Spirit, we call the Holy Spirit Angel Gabriel in Islam. So the God created the devil, God created the Angel Gabriel, which is the Holy Spirit in Christianity, and also Jesus was created by God. So we do not worship any creation, because we believe Moses, Jesus, Muhammad are all created by God. So we do not worship any creation, we worship the Creator of all creation, and that we call God. And in the Arabic language, God is basically Allah. If you read the Arabic Torah or the Bible, you're going to see the word Allah there, not God, because God is the English word, and the word Allah is also used in the Quran. So we, all Muslims, we use the word Allah, because if you translate the word Allah into English, it's going to be God. Arabic Torah and Bible, they also have the word Allah there. And Allah is actually also a very unique word. So you know, Allah cannot be, you know, plural, because in Islam God is singular, the only one. It cannot be gods. It's not like Allah's. So it's only singular. And God has no gender in Islam. So Allah, it cannot be male Allah or female Allah. It's not like, you know, God and then goddess, cannot be that. So Allah is a very unique word, actually. So all over the world, Muslims use this word because it is the most preferable and favorable word for God. It is like, so some Muslims also consider it one of the names of God. And God also has 99 names or attributes or qualities. You could just do a research, you want to find it. God has 99 names and attributes in Islam. That is the, basically the concept of God. So we do not worship Moses, Jesus, or Muhammad. We believe they are made by God, so we do not worship the creation, we worship the Creator. And we believe Moses, Jesus, Muhammad, Adam, Abraham, Noah, Solomon, these are all prophets of God. And also Muhammad is basically the last prophet. And we believe the Torah and the Bible, they did come from God. The Torah basically was, you know, given to, you know, Moses, and the Bible, we call it Injil. There was a revelation given to Jesus, we call it Injil. But we basically believe, as time went by, you know, Moses taught, the message was this, you know, the Moses' message was that God is only one, I'm the prophet of God. We believe the message of Jesus was the same, God is only one, I'm the prophet of God. So the last prophet, Muhammad, also said the same thing, God is only one, and I am the prophet of God. That's all. And we believe, you know, I'm not saying you have to believe this, you know, I'm just telling you what we believe. And whether you believe it or not, it's between you and God. And nobody can make somebody believe something. It's in your heart. Nobody can change that, you know. In the Quran, Allah says, you know, no one could guide somebody except God. So whoever Allah guides, you know, nobody can, you know, lead them astray. And whoever Allah allows to go astray, nobody can guide them. So Muslim's job is basically to convey the message, basically tell people what we believe, and whether they believe it or not, it's only between them and God. That's it. And in the Quran, it also says there is no compulsion in religion. That means nobody can force somebody to accept their religion. But we're only allowed to speak about it, tell people what we believe, sharing, you know, is caring, you know, because we love humanity, you know, and we do not want humans to burn in hell, you know. So it's not, if somebody, a Muslim, is telling another person about Islam, it does not mean that person hates them. You know, if somebody hates somebody, they would want them to burn in hell for eternity. But we Muslims, we love humanity. So that's why we tell other people, other brothers and sisters in humanity about Islam, because we do not want them to burn in hell for eternity. That's it. It's because we care. You know, we are sharing is caring, and also it's like for love of humanity, you know, and also for the sake of God. Because if somebody hates someone, they're gonna want them to burn in hell. But we love everybody, you know. So that we want people to be saved, and we want people to go to heaven. But you know, it's again, you know, if somebody wants to accept Islam or reject Islam, it's between them and God. Nobody can force anybody to accept it, because the Quran clearly says there's no compulsion in religion. Nobody can force somebody to accept religion. So that's basically it. And like, you know, Jewish people believe in one God also, but they also believe in other stuff. Like some of them don't really believe in hell. Some of them do. Some of them, most of them, do not believe in the devil, basically. And they also, I respect the Jewish people. I'm just saying what they believe. And they also do not believe Jesus is a prophet of God. They don't believe that either. There are some group who are called the Jews for Jesus, which are very minority, and most Jews also reject them. And it's basically their faith. And the Christianity and the Jewish people, they also believe God is, you know, on the right and left and up and down. It's like God is everywhere. But in Islam, we believe God is not everywhere. God is only up in heaven in his throne. That's what we believe. But God's knowledge is everywhere. So God is basically all-known, and God is the most superior. And yeah, that's it. God is all-known, and God is most superior, and God is aware of everything. God's knowledge is everywhere. But we believe God is up in heaven, above his throne. That's what we believe. We do not believe God is everywhere. But the Jewish people, they do actually believe God is everywhere. And Christians, you know, also believe that, you know, God is three in one. God the Father, the Jesus, and the Holy Spirit, the Trinity, you know, the three in one. And in Islam, we do not believe in Trinity. We basically believe God is only one. And Jesus is basically a prophet of God. And the Holy Spirit is basically Angel Gabriel, who was also created by God. And these are all creations, so we do not worship the creation. And like, God created Adam, you know, without any father and mother, so it was a miracle. And God created Jesus without any father, which is also a miracle. But God is not the father of Jesus, nor the father of Adam. That's what we believe, basically. You know, you don't have to agree with everything I'm telling. You know, you can believe whatever you want to. So the viewers, you know, all the Jewish, Christian, Muslims, Buddhists, atheists, Hindus, I hope you all, you know, share my video with everyone. I really hope Mr. Vladimir Putin, the great president of Russia, and also Mr. Donald Trump, I hope, sir, both of you watch the video, and I hope it will benefit all of humanity. So I just want to share my thoughts and opinions and my faith with the whole of humanity, and through the internet. And I hope people like it, share it with others. And this video also has a lot more information, so please watch the entire video. And I actually forgot to mention about the shaitan, the devil in Islam. Is basically, we believe devil was created from a jinn race, which is a different creation. Like, you know, there is angels, there is human, and there is a jinn race. And humans are made of mud, clay, and angels are made of light, and the jinns are made of fire. And the leader of jinn is called the Iblis. And God told, actually God gave the free will to humans and the jinn, but not to the angels. So God told the leader of angel, which is Iblis, told him to bow to Adam, prostrate to Adam. But you know, all the angels actually God told everybody to prostrate to Adam, and every angel prostrated to Adam, and Iblis was over there, and he refused to prostrate, and he basically told God, you know, I'm made of fire, and he had the free will. You know, angels do not have free will; they cannot refuse whatever God tells; they just do it. But the jinns have free will; they could refuse. If God tells them something to do, they could refuse it. The jinn, Iblis basically said, you know, I'm made of fire; he's made of clay. You know, I'm better than him. So basically, he refused God. So God cursed him and turned him into Shaitan. And basically, he was jealous of Adam, obviously, and he did not like Adam. So he also asked God to give him life until the day of judgment, and God gave him that one, and God, he also had some power. God also gave him some power, and the Shaitan is basically the goal of Shaitan is basically to whisper into the hearts of humankind. So even somebody wants to pray, you know, the Shaitan will tell them not to pray, and even if somebody wants to become a Muslim, you know, and the devil will basically tell them not to become a Muslim. You know, it's basically whispering into the hearts and minds, and the goal of the devil is basically to drive humankind to the hellfire and to make people commit shirk. Shirk is basically associating partners with God. Like, instead of believing God is only one, believing God is, you know, five, four in one, or God has a son, or God has a children. That's what we call shirk. I understand what Christians believe, and I respect that one. It's just I'm saying what we believe. Because we worship only the creator, not the creation. So it's okay if other people, you know, believe in many God or one God, or they have a different concept or different way of understanding that. I respect that one. But in Islam, we believe even if somebody associates partner with God, that is also the goal of the devil, to make people do it. And the devil is not almighty. The devil has some power, and the devil is going to die one day also. And the devil will basically die. And right now I'm just sharing the message. You know, nobody can force anybody to accept anything. But you know, I hope Mr. Vladimir Putin and Sir Donald Trump, I hope you have a successful career. You know, you guys do more good to the world. I hope, you know, you live billions of years. You know, I hope I live for billions of years. Actually, I cannot even guarantee if this world is going to last billions of years. But anyway, I'm just trying to say, you know, like, I wish everybody, you know, to live longer and a good life, and but you know, nobody can guarantee if the world is going to last for forever or billions of years. So in Islam, Christianity, Judaism, we all do believe it, you know, in some kind of judgment there, right? So please do not judge me. I don't hate anybody. I love everybody, and peace for everyone. And so please don't judge me. Let God be the judge. And there is a judgment day. We all believe that. I guess the Jews, Christians, Muslims, we all can agree that there is a judgment day. And so we all will be present in front of God one day. And God will judge us all. You know, whether. So, all the Abrahamic faiths, I know the Jews, Christians, Muslims, we agree that there is a judgment day. This world is going to end one day. And we also believe, you know, we will be present in front of God one day, and God will judge us all. So, you know, if somebody wants to, you know, accept Islam, you know, they should do it, because this world, I hope it lasts for billions of years and forever, but it might not, you know. We believe it won't, and we believe that this world is going to end one day. But I wish everybody lives for a long time, but it's just, I'm saying, I wish I lived for billions of years, but it's just not going to happen. So, so Jews, Christians, Muslims, we should, we all agree that this world is going to end one day, and there's a judgment day, and we all will be present in front of God one day. So, and God is going to judge us all. So if you want to, you know, if anybody wants to accept Islam, they should do it, and they should not let the devil deceive them, because, and please don't judge me, and let God be the judge. And the goal of the devil is to take all humankind to hell, and the devil is also cursed. After the judgment day, the devil is going to die, and it's going to burn in hell for eternity. And it does not have all the powers. It has some powers, whatever God gave it to him. Only God is almighty, and only God is all-known. And in the Judaism, people believe God is everywhere. There's no devil. And some people believe in hell or not hell. Some people don't believe in hell. Some of them believe in reincarnation. I respect that. We just do not believe that one. We believe in the devil, we believe Jesus is the prophet of God, and that's the difference. And we believe God is only up in heaven in his throne. And we do not believe, you know, there is a Holy Spirit inside, like the Christians, they believe there is a Holy Spirit inside of everyone. We don't believe that. We also call that associating partner with God. So we just say God is only up in heaven in his throne, but God is all known and God is aware of everything. And we don't believe in the Trinity. We Muslims believe there is only one God, and that's it. In the beginning, there was only one creator who created everything. We worship that creator and we call it Allah. And Allah also means God. But it also means the only one God who has no gender, no partner, doesn't eat, doesn't drink. He begins not, nor was he begotten, and he's eternal. He doesn't eat, but he feeds everyone, and he's forever. And he's also uncreated, who is the creator of all creation. And no creation can be the only God, one God only. The creator of all creation is the only true God, and we call it Allah again. And yeah, and that I explain you what is the devil, what is God in Islam. And we also believe in hell and heaven. And we Muslims basically believe in Moses, Jesus, Muhammad are made by God. Abraham, Solomon, Noah, God sent 124,000 prophets and messengers all over the world. And Muhammad was the last prophet. Quran is the last revelation from God. And we believe Islam is the complete religion. And there's no more prophet coming. There's no more revelation coming. There's no more religion coming. So Muhammad, the last prophet. And Quran is the last final revelation from God. And Islam is the complete religion. So there is no Trinity in Islam, and it's not three in one. And we believe there's only one God. You can believe three in one if you want to. That's your religion. I respect that. The Jews believe in their way. Christians believe in their way. We Muslims believe in our way. And Hindus, Buddhists, atheists. I hope all of humanity can live peacefully and united all together all over the world. I think I wish you all the best for the entire of humanity. And I wish you good luck and success for the entire world. And also, congratulations, Mr. Donald Trump, and also third Vladimir Putin and Mr. Donald Trump. I hope you know, lead the world to a better place and make the world a better place for all of humanity. And be fair, and be good, and peace for everyone. And I hope all the best for everybody, and including Sir Donald Trump. And congratulations again for winning the election, and even though I supported Hillary. But I accept Mr. Donald Trump as my president, and he's currently the president, and all Americans should stop creating riots, and we should be united, and we should accept him as our president. He's the winner. He has won the election. So, and I hope Mr. Donald Trump and Sir Vladimir Putin watch my video. So my friends and dear viewers, please watch the video and share it with others. So I really hope Sir Donald Trump and Sir Vladimir Putin, the great president of USA and Russia, gets to watch my video. It will be an honor for me if they see it, and I hope they do it. And also, I really hope, you know, I was also watching a video of Mr. Donald Trump. I saw that he was reading a book of about Hitler. So I would request Mr. Donald Trump, so if you can read a book about Hitler, I would just request you. I don't know if you really hate Muslims so much or not, if it's true or false. I don't know, according to media, you do hate Muslims. I hope you change your mind, and I hope you actually get the Quran. You know, you could even get the free Quran online. You can download a PDF file online, and there's something called guideus.tv, gainpeace.com. You know, these are places where you can, you know, order a free copy of the Quran. You can also download the free PDF file of the Quran. And also to Mr. Vladimir Putin, I think you can also get the free copy of the Quran in Russian language, and also download a PDF file. And I hope both of you, you know, all the best and good luck. And I hope you read the Quran, you know. And Mr. Donald Trump, you know, you read a book about written by Hitler, so it will not hurt you if you read the book of God. I mean, the last revelation. I know you do not believe in it, but you know, to all the believers and non-believers, I think you should read the Quran. And I think, if you, whatever religion, if you have a religion, compare it with your religious scripture. Look for the contradiction, look for the errors, and you'll find it's amazing how accurate the Quran is. And also to Mr. Donald Trump and Mr. Vladimir Putin, I hope you read the Quran, and if you follow any religion, if you're a Christian or a Jew, compare it with your religious scriptures, you know, and see if there is any contradiction. And look, which if it's word of God, it will not have much contradiction. it will be more, you know, it will make more sense, it will be more logical. So, you know, you have open mind, you know, the devil is the enemy of all of humanity. Whether that's the goal of devil is to take a humankind to hell. So I request every human being to read the Quran and whatever religion you have, compare it with your religious scriptures. And if you're an atheist, also, you know, do research on Quran and science, and you'll be amazed how much scientific facts are there in the Quran. Let me just give one last example. That is basically this, you know, in the Quran it says like there are seven stages of heavens or skies, and we're in the lowest stage, and the lowest stage is filled with, you know, stars, lights, and galaxies, and all the planets and everything. Basically, it's filled with lights, and science has, you know, confirmed that there is, you know, we cannot really see what is beyond our observable universe. Do our research, you're going to find these things are in the Quran, and science has confirmed the, you know, the observable universe is basically the in the space what we can see up to. That is the observable universe where we have all the lights and stars and planets and the galaxies and everything. You know, it's all the lights and the stars are there, and there is a limit of what we can see. It's called the observable universe, and we cannot see anything beyond that observable universe. So we don't know what exists beyond that observable universe. So I'll actually also give just do your research, okay? You'll find a lot of things about science and the Quran. And according to the Quran, this is the lowest stage of heavens, and there are seven more stages. And what exists up there, we don't know. But we believe God is all the way up in heaven above His throne, and God's knowledge is everywhere. God is all known. So again, I'm an American Bangladeshi Sunni Muslim. My name is Faisal Fahim, and I'm an American. I am an American. I love America, and I'm a New Yorker. I'm from New York City. And my name is Faisal Fahim. So please watch the entire video. This video also has some more interesting and good stuff. So please watch the entire video. I do not want you to be left confused or left lost, or, you know, not understanding something. This is a very informative and very, very educational video. So I request all of you to please watch the entire video. Thank you so much. Peace be upon all. May Allah bless America. Hello dear viewers, I'm about to put a lot of information all together. I'm basically going to put a lot of information and a couple of videos all together. It's a very interesting video. Please watch the entire video. Thank you so much.
Prophet ﷺ said that before the last day came, Islam would enter into every house, whether that house was built out of mud or on the skins of animals. And we know for sure that is coming true. There's a problem with it though. What message is going into every home is from the wrong people, with the wrong message, in the wrong way, about Islam and Muslims. It's misrepresentation. So what we are trying to accomplish bi-idhni Allah, with Allah's aid and with your dua, is that this changes and we become the right people, giving the right message in the right way for the guidance of humanity. And this is why we have called it Guide US or Guide Us, doesn't matter which one, TV. Ihdina siratal mustaqim, mustaqim, mustaqim.
I think it's long overdue to have an Islamic channel here. We are in more desperate need of a channel like that to help the non-Muslims understand Islam.
The Muslims definitely need a TV channel in America, definitely. Who's speaking for us? Who's speaking for the Muslims?
What is missing in American media is the other side of the story. We only get one side, and we're often misled to think poorly of our fellow Muslims, and they tend to turn us against each other. What we need is the other side of the story and an objective point of view.
Muslims are in desperate need of our own media outlets. us. People having a field day describing what Islam is and who the Muslims are. Every time we turn on Fox News, they're telling us what is Islam all about. No, we need some authentic sources and voices out there.
There's so many people that don't know the truth about Islam, and it's because we see so much negativity online. If it wasn't for Yusuf Estes and for my neighbor showing me the truth of Islam, I would be lost.
Growing up in America, often the feeling we had was our story was never being told. And then after September 11, not only was Islam being mentioned, but it was being mentioned in the negative light almost consistently. And the experts that were being brought, people who were most often not Muslim, by having a media, television station, television programming of our own, we take control of our narrative, we take control of our story, and then we can also invite people who are not Muslim to be able to come on board and say, here we are, talk about it, but talk about it on our terms.
So we have this huge gift of Islam to share with the American people. And without a media, we're just like that tree falling in the dark night in the forest and no one knows about it. Yet.
اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
I'm Yusuf Estes, founder of Guide US TV. This project for our station is for all people everywhere, dedicated to presenting real Islam in simple English. There have been voices right along talking about Islam, but are they being fair? It's time that you and I get the voice of real Islam out there.
A little over a month now, that's how I found it, was Chat Islam.
He's been coming on the chat channel.
I go on Chat Islam every morning at 9 o'clock, well, about 8 o'clock to about noontime.
There was one place that it was all concentrated in that I could show my son and my family, then I would definitely have it in my house.
Because of people taking the time out to actually create these channels online, that helped guide me to where I am today.
The possibilities are endless, and it's a great thing. It should be available as soon as possible.
If Guide Us TV was in our house, we'd be more informed. I always believe that when we know better, we do better. Alhamdulillah. And with Guide Us TV, we will know better. Inshallah, we will do better.
These programs at Guide Us TV are designed to be the voice of Islam, to bring together the communities on a national and global level, and to be the hub of learning for both Muslims and non-Muslims alike, based on the Quran and the authentic teachings of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him.
Here are a few of our programs. Beauties of Islam. Ramadan Reminders, The Mailbox, Stories of the Prophets,
and so many more.
Welcome to this week's episode of Bridge to Faith.
Here's some of the proofs of what happens when real Islam gets out.
My life was a mess before Islam. Alhamdulillah, I met a Muslim brother who introduced me to the Quran. And I listened to it 3 times, and by that time I could not deny the truth. So I became Muslim, and since then my life has been blessed. Alhamdulillah.
I just came to Islam tonight, and the reason why is because I found Islam always a blessing, a true blessing. And Yusuf Estes, oh, thank you Allah, guided me here tonight to make my shahada.
The big event for me tonight was I took my shahada and entered Islam.
Along with our media partners like Dr. Zakir Naik with Peace TV, Muhammad Salah with Huda TV, Imam Mutayr Sabri, Sheikh Salam Al Amri, Yusha Evans, Dr. Bilal Phillips, Dr. Yasser Qadi, Baba Ali, all of us working together to produce shows like Islam 101, Hearts to Hearts, Radiant Lights, Jewels of the Prophet, news specials, documentaries, and more. You and I know what's already out there and the effect that it's having on our society and our world today.
If we have a resource like Guide US TV, the notion is that people should be subscribing to it. Why? Because in the middle of all of this other ignorance and other programming that's going on, this will be the source of light for the household.
Guide US TV is, inshallah, I think it's going to be a great success.
We absolutely need a channel.
Guide US TV is how I found Islam.
If you're looking for it, this is it. Guide US is it.
We've heard the voices and we know how important it is to put Guide US TV in every home for the Muslims and all mankind. But we need your help. Contribute your support online at Guide US TV. That's www.guideus.tv. If not now, then when? Assalamu alaikum.
الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
Hello, Mr. Donald Trump and dear Christians, how you guys doing? I hope you are doing well. And I'm an American Muslim, and you know the freedom of, we have the First Amendment, which gives us the freedom of speech and freedom of religion. And as an American Muslim, I love my country, I love America. And yes, American Muslims, we all love America, we love this country. We love the freedom of speech, the First Amendment, and which gives us freedom of religion. We respect this country, love this country. I just want to talk about religion. I'm not a politician. I don't want to talk about media or politics. I just want to talk about religion, basically. We believe Islam is a religion of peace, mercy, you know, kindness, you know, sincerity, and it's basically about submitting to God, you know, worshiping God. And loving one another, loving other humans. And in the Quran it says, if you kill one single human being, it is as if you have killed the entire of humanity. If you just save one single human being, it is as if you have saved the entire of humanity. So like I said, we believe in peace and love. We don't believe in hate and killing others. We don't believe that one. And our Prophet Muhammad, he said, even in a state of war, do not kill the civilians or women or children, etc. And the Quran says, if they seek peace, you seek peace. So, we're against violence, we're against killing, we're against crime and everything else. We just believe in peace and mercy and love. And like I said, I love America. This is my country, and we're American Muslims, and we love the First Amendment, freedom of speech, and freedom of religion, everything we get over here. We respect this country. And so, Mr. Donald Trump and other dear Christians, I would like to introduce you about the basics of Islam, what Islam really is. Okay, so we actually have five pillars of Islam. And the first pillar is, we believe that there is no God but Allah. And Allah also means God, because if you look into the Arabic Torah or Bible, it says Allah over there, not God. And we believe there's only one God, and Moses, Jesus, Muhammad, these are only prophets of God. And the second pillar is basically Salah, like praying five times a day, worshipping God, praising God. Another one is after that is called Zakat, Zakah. It's basically a mandatory charity, like 2.5% of our income. We just basically have to, like a percentage of our income, we have to donate to the poor people. Like whatever we earn, the yearly income, and like 2.5% of that, a percentage of our yearly income, we must have to donate it to the poor. It's like a command of God. That's called charity, obligatory charity. And after that, that is when we have to fast in the month of Ramadan. This is right now the month of Ramadan 2016. And which basically, like, you know, just I'm giving an example, like we probably have to fast from early, like maybe 5 o'clock, I mean, not 5, like 3:30 to like 3:30 a.m. to like 8:30 p.m. You know, this is the time we don't drink or eat food. It's basically, it's not really a sacrifice or anything. It's, you know, like so many people around the world, they do not get to eat food. And it's like, and it's not that either. It's basically, we're doing it to discipline ourselves, you know, our body. And it's scientifically proven that fasting is actually good for health also. If you do your research on Google or anywhere, you'll find that it is, fasting is actually good for health. And it's basically, we do it for the sake of God, you know, it's basically God commanded us to do it. That's why we do it, and we expect our reward in the hereafter or the life after. So we can, you know, go to heaven with the rewards from God, and by fulfilling our duties. And actually, we actually also believe that Jesus, Moses, you know, even Solomon, Abraham, Noah, and all the previous prophets before Muhammad, the last prophet, peace be upon him, all prophets actually, we believe they were Muslim, and they actually have, they fasted, they, it was prescribed for them to worship God and also fast and all those things. We Muslims do, we believe all the previous prophets have done the same, because we believe Adam, Abraham, Moses, Jesus, Muhammad, and Noah, Solomon, all of them came from one God. So there has to be only one God, and all prophets came from one God, and Islam is basically the complete religion. And all other, we believe all the prophets came from the same God. And about the other, another pillar of Islam, I was talking about the five pillars of Islam. I'm talking about the Shahada, like, I mean the faith, you know, believing in one God, and fasting, donation, and charity. And another one is, what do you call it? The Hajj. Yeah, it's basically every Muslim once in a lifetime we have to go to the Mecca and perform Hajj. It's like a religious, like a worshiping, you know. It's basically we go to the Mecca, like in Kaaba, basically. We go there once in a lifetime. It's like a command of God for us to go there and, you know, do the tawaf, like go around circle and, you know, stuff like that. It's basically we worship God who is up in heaven. And the Kaaba is basically, it's like a room, you know. It even has a door, and it could break, somebody could get inside and clean it and fix it. It's a very small place, and we cannot just go inside it, and all of us cannot worship it there. It's basically a ritual we do. It's basically a command of God, so we have to go there and perform the pilgrimage. But we believe God is not in this world, not around us, not over here. God is up in heaven in his throne. God is above his throne, and he's in heaven up there, not in this world around us or inside of us or inside Kaaba or anything. And like, you know, like Christians also go to the church and they worship, you know. So Jews go to the, you know, synagogue and they worship. It doesn't mean Jews and Christians worship the church or synagogue, right? So similarly, we just go to the Kaaba, and it's like a holy place, and like how, you know, we just go and worship. That's it. It doesn't mean we worship the Kaaba. And yeah, basically that's it. And we love America, and we love the First Amendment, the freedom of speech, freedom of religion, and Mr. Donald Trump, and dear other Christians. I hope you watch the entire video. It has lots of information. This is an informative video. This is an educational video. This is about sharing the knowledge and wisdom and peace with everybody. And like I said, you know, I'm an American Muslim, and I love America. This is my country, and all American Muslims love their country, and we all love America, and we support America. And I hope Mr. Donald Trump and other Christians who has negative ideas about Islam will look into Islam and try to understand more about it. And we love America, and we're peaceful people. And Allah means God, because in the Arabic word, if you look into the Torah and the Bible in the Arabic language, you're going to find the word Allah there. Allah basically means God. So basically, hope everybody all the good, and I wish you all the best to everybody. And to Mr. Donald Trump and to all the other dear Christians. I just want to say please watch the entire video. It has a lot of information. Hope you enjoy it and like it, and please share it with others and give some thumbs up and share it with others. And I just want to spread the peace and love. That's all, nothing else. And God bless, and may God bless you. May God, you know, guide you, and love, peace, and God bless, and may God guide us all. May God bless and guide you all, and may God bless and guide us all also. Thank you so much, and enjoy the rest of the video. Take care. Peace.
والله يدعو إلى دار السلام ويهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome to this episode of The Beauties of Islam. I'm your host Yusuf Festus. And for the next little while, I'd like to talk about one of the beauties of Islam that I found amazing. When I came into Islam, I had this misconception about something called equality. We constantly hear about people talking about equal rights and the equality of men and women, the equality of this and that and so on. But when we look to Islam, we find something amazing, something better than equality. Now, I know you're probably thinking, wait a minute, what is he talking about? How can you have something better than equal? Well, the first thing to consider is this. A man and a woman are not really equal. They're different. If they weren't different, why would we have two separate names for these two groups? So obviously there's a difference. It doesn't mean one's better than the other one. It means they're different. So Islam is providing for us something better than equality. And that's what our program is going to be about today. We're going to talk about this beauty of Islam, this something better than equality. I want to call your attention to something that is well known and well established. For the most part, most men are larger, bigger, stronger physically than most women. Occasionally there'll be an exception to the rule, but it's known and established that that's the way it is. And since the time of Adam, peace be upon him, and until now, we find that even the expressions we use in our language describe that. We call the women the fairer sex. Meaning what? Obviously, we're showing that the women have something different than men. And how do we deal with that in Islam? And this is one of the beauties that really got me excited, and I began to understand something on a much deeper level. The word we want to use is not equality, it's equity. Equity means ownership in something, or the value of something for you. And what is the value for you or I when we start to talk about this subject of men versus women? If you said, well, I want everything to be the same for the men as it is for the women, what would happen? A lot of people will tell you this is a good thing. They want the same pay structure for a man as they do for a woman. By the way, I don't have a problem with that. I think that's a great idea. Women, if they do the same job, need to have proper compensation, and there's no doubt. As far as being treated properly, there's no doubt about that either. This is something Islam guarantees. But there are other things that you have to look beyond just a few basic needs or wants and see what's the total picture. The one who created us in the first place, we call him Allah, you might call him God. The point is, he's the creator and the sustainer of the universe. He, more than anyone else, should know what he created. And he should be the one responsible to to tell us how to deal with his creation. We find, even in the remnants of what still exists from the old scriptures and manuscripts, reference to this subject. Unfortunately, we don't have the originals for those anymore. So occasionally people have got their own little hands in there, and you can't exactly say this is from God and this is from man. What's inspired by God? What's inspired by man? And what's the inspired word of God to man, etc., etc.? So when we look to the Quran, we have something great. What is it? It is the exact words, the exact speech of Allah in his last and final revelation to mankind. Now, if you're not Muslim, or if you're talking to somebody that's not Muslim, they're going to say, well, I reject that immediately. I don't want to accept it. But stop and think. This is what the Muslims are talking about. So at least let's understand where they're coming from with this concept that they have. According to the Muslims, and according to Muhammad, peace be upon him, the speech from Allah is exactly today as it was when it first came to him in the beginning. And in that speech, Allah taught all of us how to deal with each other in many levels, in many ways. And above all, he says in his speech how much he hates and forbids oppression or dhulm. So for sure, we're going to see right away that whether you call it equity or equality, Allah is saying that he's against the thing that we're all against, which is what? Oppression. Aggression and oppression, that which puts down or the wrongdoing. Okay, now, let's consider the condition of a woman. Is a woman really like a man? A woman can have a baby and a man can't. For this reason alone, we should observe and pay close attention to the needs of the woman. We should pay close attention to the suffering and the condition that she's in when she's going to have a baby, while she's having the baby, and after she has the baby. Why? Because this is something amazing. A man can never, in his wildest imagination, even guesstimate the amount of pain and suffering that a woman goes through, even through one birth pain. I recall when my wife was having her child, a little girl, many, many years ago, and my wife grabbed my hand while she was having one of the, what they call contraction. This is a big pain that a woman has when she's delivering the baby. She grabbed my hand, and she began to squeeze and press until my hand felt like it was going to break, and I was like, oh my God! Later, I asked her about that. I said, what was this squeezing you did on my hand? It hurt so bad. You know, you almost broke my fingers. She said, oh, you can't imagine the pain. I said, well, give me some idea. She said, a man will never understand this pain. I said, well, any kind of an idea. She said, first, take your lower lip. I said, okay, like this? Yeah. She said, now pull it up over the top of your head. I said, what? She said, and even then, you wouldn't begin to understand the pain. So we see there's something different here, something very different between a man and a woman. I want to take a break and let you reflect on what I just said. I want you to think about this, because when we come back with more Beauties of Islam, I want to go into this and show you the difference between what we call equality and equity. Sit right there. Don't go away. We're going to be right back with more Beauties of Islam.
Islam is keeping up the pace. Islam is for every race.
We're back. You're watching our program called Beauties of Islam. What we were talking about is the difference between something called equality and something called equity. And we've already discovered that a woman and a man are different. Now, anybody that studied biology knows that. But a funny thing happened one time. I was in India, and a doctor came to me, and he said, I'm not a Muslim, and I like a lot of the things that I've read about Islam, especially when he talks about the miracles found in the Quran and the science that's there in Islam. 1,400 years ago, people couldn't have known those things. Many things, the idea that God is one. And he's very sold on Islam. He said, except one thing. I said, what is that? He said, the way that Islam is treating a woman different than a man. I said, you're a doctor? He said, yes. I said, PhD or medical? He said, no, I'm a medical doctor. I said, and you don't know the difference between a man and a woman? And he started laughing, and we were kidding around, you know. And I said, no, seriously, there's a difference between men and women. He said, absolutely. I said, and do you prescribe exactly the same treatment or medication for a patient that's a woman that is, and a man? He said, well, in some cases you can, but not in all cases, because, and he started to explain why. I said, hold on. That's my point exactly. In some cases, you can see easily that the man and the woman are on equal footing. But in other cases, they're not. And this is when you have to go to what we call equity, meaning to give what's properly due for the individual or the group, which is not the same as for the other individuals or group. Let me explain. And I began to talk to him about the differences that Islam is offering for men and women. The first thing and foremost in Islam that every Muslim has to do is to declare what's called Shahada. We say, Ashadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashadu Muhammad Rasulullah. I bear witness in open testimony that there's no God or deity to worship except the real God. And I bear witness that Muhammad brought this message. And Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the messenger of God, and I'm going to do my best to follow him. This is the meaning. And this is the same for men and women. The same. There's no difference. Immediately after a person does this thing called Shahada, the next thing they're responsible for is something called Salawat al-Khams. Five times a day to establish their prayers. To stand, bow, prostrate, and sit, and do this repetition five times a day. This is a form of ibadah or worship in Islam. Yes? Yes. I said, now, every Muslim has to do this how many times a day? Five. How many days a week? Seven. How many days a month? 30. Wait a minute. Not women. He said, why? I said, during her monthly cycle, her menstruation cycle, which could be 7, 8, or 10 days, how many days it is, she's forbidden to do her salah or worship at that time. Why? Well, because Allah has ordered it so. He does not want her to do that. Do you imagine that the woman is in pain and suffering? So Allah doesn't want her distracted in the salah like this, and he allows her just to keep Allah in her mind by doing what's called dhikr, remembering Allah, reciting Quran to herself, but she doesn't do the salah, and she doesn't make it up. He said, oh, I didn't think of that. So wait a minute. There's a lot of things you and I won't think about because we didn't create human beings. He said, you're right. I said, okay, next. The next thing after the salah is called zakah. Zakah is to pay something on your wealth. How much wealth you hold in a year's time. And then at the end of the year, whatever you didn't use, you pay a tax on that, like 2.5% to the poor and the needy. It's the same for the men as it is for the women, and there's no difference. He said, okay, that makes sense. I said, but then the next one is called Ramadan, Psalm Ramadan. This is fasting. Now, again, all 30 days of the month of Ramadan, a man and a woman are not supposed to eat or drink or have intimate relations, except for the woman. In this case, the woman is excused from those same days again. So if she has 6, 7, 8, or 10 days, whatever it is that she's in her cycle, she just marks her calendar for those days, and then she can make up the fasting. Although she doesn't have to do the salah, that she didn't make that up. But she can make up the fasting at days of the year, which are more convenient and easier. And by the way, can you imagine in the hottest time of the year, she's getting time off. And then in the winter months, she could choose, I'll take those easy days. And then we come to the one called Hajj. And Hajj, again, there's a difference between men and women. A man must make Hajj or pilgrimage once in his life when Allah makes a way for him to go. But the woman, she doesn't have to do this unless she has a man to go along with her, to protect her and help her. Even if she didn't get to do Hajj, Allah could give her the reward for it. Because why? Because Allah is giving something better than equality. He's giving equity. The woman and the man are different. And Allah knows what He created. And He made this way of life, Deen of Islam, for what He created. And that's one of the beauties of Islam. Until next time, peace. Salaam alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Islam is peace. Islam.
Under the scorching sun on the plains of Arafat, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam delivered his final sermon. O people, listen to my words carefully, for I know not whether after this year I shall ever meet you again at this place. O people, your lives and your property are sacrosanct until you meet your Lord, as are this holy place, this holy day, and this holy month. Remember that you will indeed meet your Lord and answer for your deeds. So beware. Whoever of you is holding a trust, let him return it to its rightful owner. All usury is abolished. Your capital, however, is yours to keep. Wrong not, and you shall not be wronged. All bloodshed from the pagan age of ignorance is to be left unavenged. O people, the devil has lost all hope of ever being worshipped in this land of yours. Nevertheless, he will try to mislead you in smaller matters. Beware of him, therefore, for the safety of your religion. Time has turned, and it is as it was the day that God created the heavens and the earth. The number of months is 12. 4 of them are holy, in which war and fighting are forbidden. O man, you have your rights over your wives, and they have rights over you. It is your right that they do not fraternize with anyone of whom you do not approve. But if they do, Allah has permitted you to isolate them within their homes and chastise them without cruelty. But if they abide by your rights, then they have the right to be fed and clothed in kindness. Do treat your women well and be kind to them, for they are your partners and committed helpers. You have taken them only as a trust from Allah, and you have their enjoyment only by His permission. So listen to me in earnest, O people, and reason well. I leave behind me two things, the Quran and my example. If you follow them, you will not go astray. O people, listen to my words. Know that every Muslim is a brother to every Muslim, and that all Muslims constitute one brotherhood. It is only lawful to take from a brother what he gives you willingly, so wrong not yourselves. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then faced the heavens and said, Be my witness, O Allah, that I have conveyed your message to your people. It was then that some of the final words of the Quran were revealed.
اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا.
This day I have perfected your religion for you, and have completed my favor upon you, and have chosen for you as religion Al-Islam.
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
It's good to see you again.
I was just looking at this flyer about the Dean Show.
Well, that's why we're here.
You walk up.
I got some more good news for you.
Tell me.
We got another good topic and we'd like to bring you back on to cover it.
All right, it sounds great. Wait a minute. What's the topic this time?
The Trinity.
The Trinity? Okay, let's go talk
about
the Trinity.
Let's go talk about the Trinity.
That's a good idea.
Handsome Yusuf cried,
Allah is enough for me.
Welcome back to the D-Show. I'm your host, Eddie. Now, you coming from a Christian background, you, your father, who knew the Bible very well, he was also a minister. I'm sure you can really help give some insight to this topic, the Trinity.
When we talk about the Trinity, this is not really three gods. This is one of the things that the folks who criticize the Catholic Church, they're the ones who really came up with this idea to start with. And then subsequently, any churches that broke off from the Catholic Church, those who protested, or Protestants, they carried that forward as well. But there are those who criticize the Trinity, not realizing how this all came about. It's not fair. And then there are those who claim to be Unitarians because they say we believe in the unity of God as one. And then the Trinitarians, of course, are saying that God is one, but right away, real fast, but there are three natures to God, or there are three parts within one, or the demonstration that I gave about the finger when you mm-hmm. can move it like that. So, how did one become three? Let's ask it like that, because in fact, the Old Testament, the Bible, the Jewish belief, and so on, even till today, is God is one. And there's no consideration for anything else. And there's not two, not three, not four. It's one.
So Abraham, did Abraham ever utter this word Trinity, or Moses, or Noah?
As far as uttering a word Trinity, the word is Latin. None of them spoke the Latin language. They wouldn't have used it anyway. And as far as that goes, the word Trinity itself is not found in any of the scriptures, not even in the Apocrypha. You don't find this word.
How about for when one says, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Son?
But we said the word Trinity is not that. Okay, the word Trinity is not in the Bible, not in any scripture. That word Trinity is not there. It's not until you get to the Quran that you find this word.
So what is this verse that I just quoted you that people used to support the Trinity?
The verse that you're talking about now, this is in John, but it's not John the Gospel. This is the John 1, or the first epistle of John. And it's not necessarily even the same John anyway.
Yeah.
It's in chapter 5, verse 7. And it says, there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, and these three are one. This verse is a matter of, as a matter of fact, is an addition. And all of the scholars of the Bible agree that this was added many, many, many centuries later by someone who wanted to resolve this issue once and for all and prove that somehow there could be three.
Let me get this straight. So this is not in the original manuscript?
Well, nobody can say it's not because they don't have the original manuscript.
So it's not in the copy of the copy?
But it's not in anything. No, it's not in anything within, I think, the first the first 1,000 years, okay? Anything in the first 1,000 years wouldn't have had that. It was added much later in the Koine Greek.
Gotcha.
Okay. Now, there were things that were in Trinity, mentioning Trinity, that were injected in some of these Latin copies and so on, but those were rejected anyway. But in the Koine Greek, there was never anything in any of the early manuscripts or anything that came after that. That was, you know, anything serious that used this word Trinity.
Yeah.
And nor was there anything with this verse in it. Okay, what it is, it's a takeoff of the verse before it and a rewording of that verse to try to add what they wanted to. It says in the verse before it that there are three that bear witness, the Father, the Blood, and the Spirit, and these three agree. The Father, the Blood, and the Spirit, and these three agree. And it doesn't say they're all in heaven, and it doesn't say that they are one. It says they agree. But it was a chance for somebody to say, wait, look, here's three things. Now we'll try to wrap it up and turn it into something. There were some very serious fights. And we're not talking about just fights with words. We're talking about the kind of fights where people were being poisoned, people being killed
over this subject. That's how really horrible it got by the third century. There was something called Arianism versus the Council of Nicaea. This is, I'm referring to something I have on a website about this. And Arius is the one who was insisting that the nature of Jesus was such that he's not divine and he's not a part of God. But they were always arguing over how you explain the nature of Jesus. Is he created or is he born? Is he begotten or is he not begotten? And the wording on how you would say that would determine whether or not you were considered to be a kafir, a disbeliever. And so that's how this kicks off. And then the Nicaea Council offers a resolution on that. Basically, if you don't agree with this, we'll kill you. It was almost that bad.
Was this over the rule of Constantine?
Constantine was the one basically who was presiding over the council himself. And yet he was a pagan sun god worshiper. He was in the cult called Saul Invictus. Saul is sun in Latin. Invictus means invincible. They believed that the sun was invincible, and they believed that the sun had a sun on earth, which was basically the representative of the sun power, etc. And he considered himself to be that one. And only 5 years before this council, he had actually engaged in a war against some of the people who believed in Jupiter as being the god, you know, the planet Jupiter.
Yes.
And the guy who was the son of Jupiter was killed by him in that war. So he considered himself the big warrior. But to come back to this Trinity business, when Constantine convened this council, what he was looking for is absolution. He wanted to be rid of his guilt and sin for having drowned his, or actually boiling his wife and boiled his son, because of the fear that they would try to compete with him for his position.
Talk about emperor. Insecurity, huh?
Well, in any case, he found a way to get it done. It was through this one sect of Christianity said that if he would say that Jesus was the Son of God and died for his sins, then they would forgive him of his sins.
Yeah, interesting.
And then the trade-off was then that the Roman government would now be forced to accept this particular sect of Christianity as the royal or the official church of the realm. And with that, this gave these bishops a good position. Because prior to that time, you know, the Roman government was killing people who were Christians and using them for entertainment. Take them out, throw them into the gladiators, throw them out to the lions and bears, things like that. It was horrible. It was disgraceful. And it was, of course... they were killing people.
So up until then, if I get this straight, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't want to put words in your mouth, that we had a stream of true monotheism coming from one direction. Then you had another stream coming from another direction, and it seems that this direction of the Trinity came over and Romanized Christianity with all their traditions that were going on.
No, I don't think so. I don't think that's what we're saying here. Is the more you study this, I don't think you'll see that Christianity became influenced by that. I think this was just Rome's church adapting a few things from them, that's all. Because at the council...
My name is Haji Muhammad. Brother Zakir, you mentioned in your talk that Jesus never claimed divinity. But it is mentioned in the Bible that Jesus said, I and my Father are one. Does this not imply that he claimed divinity?
Brother, I have a question that I said in my talk, that nowhere does the Bible say that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, claimed divinity. And he gave a quotation of the Bible that Jesus said, I and my Father are one. What the brother is quoting is a verse from the Bible in the Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse number 30, which does say, I and my father are one. But when you ask the Christian missionaries that what is the context, I have not yet met a Christian missionary who can tell you the context without opening the Bible. He knows I and my father are one, but he doesn't know the context. For example, if I quote to someone that the Quran says do not pray, most of the Muslims will be shocked. What am I talking? And if you open it, does say do not pray, but it's half the verse. Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 43 says, do not pray with your mind before. Do not pray when you're intoxicated. So if I only quote, do not pray, it will mean Quran says don't pray. Half the quotation. So for context, I and my father are one, you have to go to Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse number 23, and I'm quoting from my memory, that Jesus walked into the temple in Solomon's porch, verse number 24. It says, and the Jews came around him and asked him, how long dost thou make us doubt? If thou art the Christ, tell us plainly. Verse number 25 says, I told you, but you believe me not. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. Verse number 26 says, that you believe not, because you are not my sheep, as I said unto you. The Jews, they were asking Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, that why don't you speak plainly? So he tells them that, yes, I am the Messiah. I have told you clearly, but because you are not my sheep, you don't believe in me. Verse number 27 continues. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, continues saying that my sheep, they hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. Verse 28, that I give them eternal life, no man can pluck them out of my hand, and they shall not perish. Verse number 29 says, my Father who giveth to me, he is greater than all. No man can pluck them out of my Father's hand. Then verse number 30 says, I and my Father are one. Any person who has a little bit sense can make out, I and my Father are one, doesn't mean one as one person. It means one in purpose. Verse number 28 says, no man can pluck them out of my hand. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, saying, no man can pluck them out of my hand. Verse 29 is saying, no man can pluck them out of my Father's hand. Verse number 30 says, I and my Father are one. In purpose, both Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, and Almighty God, they are one in purpose. If I say that my father is a doctor, and he is a doctor, alhamdulillah, even I am a doctor. If I say, I and my father are one, what does it mean? It means one in purpose. As medical profession, my father is a doctor, even I am a doctor. It doesn't mean that I and my father are one. It means my father is a medical doctor, even I am a medical doctor. But Christians say, no, no, it means one, actual unity. So we say, okay, you say actual unity, let's read further. If you go ahead in the Gospel of John, chapter number 17, verse number 21, it says that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said that he, all of them are one. My Father in me and I in thee, we all are one. Does it mean that God Almighty is in Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ is in all his 12 disciples? So there will be 14 God. Jesus Christ, God Almighty and 12 disciples. The same one is used there and here. If you go to the source, the same word is used. If you go to the Greek, same word is used. So does it mean you have 14 gods? And among those disciples, Judas was a traitor. Even he is God. Thomas doubted Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Is he God? Peter, Jesus Christ says, he is satanic. Is he also God? No. All of them, God Almighty, Jesus Christ and the apostles, are one in purpose. They are same. Again, if you go two verses ahead, Gospel of John, chapter 17, verse 23 says, that I am in thee and you and me, he tells the disciples. Does it make all of them God? No. It means one in purpose. But then Christian will say, okay, I've quoted the first part. Why don't you quote after that? After verse number 30, Gospel of John chapter 10. Let's go ahead. Gospel of John chapter number 10, verse number 31 says, and Jews picked up stones again to stone at Jesus, peace be upon him. Verse number 32 says, and Jesus, peace be upon him, asked them, for which of the good works of my Father do you stone me? Verse 33 says, that we don't stone you for any good work, but because you blaspheme, being a man, call yourself God, that's why we stone you. Verbatim. I'm reading from my memory. Any person wants to check up, can check up. It's there in the Bible. Gospel of John, chapter 10, verse 23 onwards. I'm quoting. So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, gives the answer. The Jews say that, see, he's trying to blaspheme calling himself God. Good riddance, they want to kill him. Good riddance. The Christians say, oh, the Jews called him God Almighty. See, they understood him correctly for redemption. One wants for redemption, they're calling him God. The other group of people for good riddance. But the answer is given in the next verse. Verse number 34 of John chapter 10, Gospel of John chapter 10, says that, is it not mentioned in your scriptures that ye are God? And if the person to whom the word of God came, if he says God, the scripture is not broken. If you check up in the Bible, in the Psalm chapter number 82, verse number 6 does say that ye are God. So Jesus Christ gave the answer that the person to whom the word of God came, if you call him God, it is not blaspheme. It is meaning that they are one in purpose. Hope that answers the question.
Yes, we have a non-Muslim brother.
Yes, you're most welcome, brother.
I'm Christopher. I just want to know, because the Holy Quran says, believe in the messenger, Prophet Muhammad. And the Holy Bible says, those who believe in Jesus will have eternal life. And both, as according to the Quran, both of them are messengers of God. And I want to know, where did Jesus make his mistake? Where did he make any mistake that he is unable to save the people?
Brother, that's a very good question. The Quran says, believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Bible says, believe in Jesus, he will give eternal life. So where did Jesus make a mistake? So according to the Quran, both of them, where did he make a mistake? Brother, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, never made any mistake. It is the church which made a mistake. According to us, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is one of the mightiest messengers of God. When Jesus says that I am the way, the truth and the life, no man cometh unto my father but through me, is correct. That means he was the messenger of God. Same thing what Prophet Muhammad said. At the time of Jesus, peace be upon him, according to Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 6, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, I am the way, the truth and the life. No man cometh unto to my father but through me. That means if you follow the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, you will go to your father. That means you will go to Jannah, you will go to paradise. Eternal life means paradise. Similarly, if you today, but Jesus Christ also said, I have many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Gospel of John chapter 16, verse number 7. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. Talking about Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So today as a Christian, if you really love Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, you have to follow the teaching of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So Jesus Christ never made a mistake. It is the church which says Jesus is God. Jesus Christ never claimed divinity. As I mentioned earlier, if any Christian can point out a single unequivocal statement, a single unambiguous statement where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, or he says worship me, I am ready to accept Christianity. It is the church which has a mistake, not Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. In fact, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, it's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 28. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, my Father is greater than I. Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse number 29. My Father is greater than all. Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 12, verse number 38. I cast out devil with the Spirit of God. Gospel of Luke, chapter number 11, verse number 20. I with the finger of God cast out devil. Gospel of John, chapter number 5, verse number 30. I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just. For I seek not my will, but the will of my Father. Anyone who says, I seek not my will, but the will of Almighty God, is a Muslim. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was a Muslim. He never claimed divinity. And it is clearly mentioned in the book of Acts, chapter number 2, verse number 22, that ye men of Israel, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God amongst you by wonders and miracles and signs which God did by him, and you are witness to it. A man approved of God amongst you by wonders and miracles and signs which God did by him, and you are witness to it. So never did Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, claim divinity. And Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was never wrong. It is the false understanding of the Bible. So I, as a believer in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, a person who loves Jesus, peace be upon him, I say that I am more Christian than the Christian themselves. If Christian means a person who follows the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, I am more Christian than the Christian themselves. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 5, verse number 17:20. Think not that I have come to destroy the law of the prophets. I have come not to destroy but to fulfill. For until the heaven and the earth pass away, not one jot or tittle shall pass away from the law until all be fulfilled. For whosoever shall break one of the least commandments and teach men to do so shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. And whosoever shall keep the commandments and teach the same will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Unless the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees exceeds the righteousness. Unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, in no way shall you enter the kingdom of heaven. So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, you cannot break a single law or a tittle of the Old Testament. It's mentioned in the Old Testament, in the book of Leviticus, chapter number, verse number 7 and 8, that you should not have poked. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 14, verse number 8, you should not have poked. It's mentioned in the book of Isaiah, chapter number 65, verse number 2 to 5, you should not have poked. The Christians have poked, but the Muslims don't have poked. It's mentioned in the book of Ephesians, chapter number 5, verse number 18, and the book of Proverbs, chapter number 20, verse number 8, that you should not be drunk with wine. We Muslims don't have alcohol, but the Christians have alcohol. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is mentioned in the Gospel of Luke that he was circumcised on the 8th day. The Muslims are circumcised, most of the Christians are not circumcised. So if Christian means a person who follows the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, we Muslims are more Christian than the Christians themselves. We love Jesus Christ. We respect him, we revere him, we follow him, but we don't worship him because he was the messenger of God and was not God. Hope that answers the question, brother. So do you believe that Jesus is the messenger of God?
Yes, of course.
Do you believe that Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God?
I don't.
You don't?
Because I believe in the Bible.
But Bible says in the Gospel of John, it's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 12 to 14, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, I have many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself. All that he hears shall he speak. He shall glorify me. Who is this person Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, talking about? Who? Haven't you studied your Bible?
Yeah, no, he has spoken about the Holy Spirit of the
Lord. Okay, very good. That means you know your Bible now. You are saying this Spirit of truth, what Jesus Christ is speaking about is the Holy Spirit. Go a few verses before. Gospel of John chapter 16 verse number 7. It says that it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter shall not come. The criteria for this Spirit should come is Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, should depart. For if I go away, shall I send him? The Holy Spirit was already there before Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, came. He was also there when Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was there. He was there in the womb of Elizabeth. He was there when Jesus was being baptized. So how can this be the Holy Spirit? Tell me. That means you don't understand the... Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, for if I go not away, the Comforter shall not come. For if I go, shall I send him? So the requirement of the Spirit of truth should come is that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, should depart. When Jesus Christ is there, this Comforter cannot come. Holy Spirit was already there when Jesus was there. So how can you say this prophecy refers to the Holy Spirit, my dear brother? Can you help me to understand the Bible?
Yes.
It doesn't refer to the Holy Spirit. It refers to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And his prophecy is also mentioned in the Old Testament, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 18, verse number 18. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 18, verse number 19. It's mentioned in the book of Isaiah, chapter number 29, verse number 12. In the Song of Solomon, chapter number 5, verse number 16. In the New Testament, Gospel of John, chapter 14, verse 16. Gospel of John, chapter 15, verse 26. Gospel of John, chapter 16, verse number 7. Gospel of John, chapter 16, verse number 12 to 14. All these references are talking about no one but Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. I have given a talk on Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Bible. Now I am asking you, if you believe in the Bible, when Jesus Christ has prophesied the coming of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, why don't you believe in Jesus that Prophet Muhammad is the last messenger? Why? That means you believe half the teachings of Jesus Christ not complete?
Because the teaching says, I'll send you a comforter.
Correct.
He never mentioned about a person or any name was indicated
okay.
on there.
Song of Solomon, chapter number 5, verse number 16. I'm quoting in Hebrew. Hikkum ametakim vikulli muhammadim zaydudi wa zayrai baina Jerusalem. His by name is mentioned. Hikkum ametakim vikulli muhammadim. Muhammad is the name. Im is for respect. They say he's altogether lovely. O daughter of Jerusalem. His name is mentioned also in the Old Testament. Song of Solomon, chapter 5, verse 16. Now do you believe?
I'll refer it.
Ask your church first.
No, not the church.
Who will have to ask?
I'll go through it and confirm myself.
So how long will it take to confirm?
Okay, tonight.
Tonight? Yeah. Fine, I'm going day after tomorrow. So by tomorrow morning, you can ask the organizer, contact me. Fine? Sir. Either you accept Islam, or if you can't prove, then if you prove Jesus is God, I'll accept Christianity. If you cannot, you accept Islam.
Praise the Lord.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Kaf, Ha, Ya, Ain, Sod. This is a mention of the mercy of your Lord to his servant Zechariah, when he called to his Lord a private supplication. He said, My Lord, indeed my bones have weakened, and my head has filled with white, and never have I been in my supplication to you, my Lord, unhappy. And indeed, I fear the successors after me, and my wife has been barren, so give me from yourself an heir, who will inherit me and inherit from the family of Jacob, and make him, my Lord, pleasing to you. He was told, O Zechariah, indeed, we give you good tidings of a boy whose name will be John. We have not assigned to any before this name. He said, My Lord, how will I have a boy when my wife has been barren and I have reached extreme old age? An angel said, Thus it will be. Your Lord says, It is easy for me, for I created you before, while you were nothing. Zechariah said, My Lord, make for me a sign. He said, Your sign is that you will not speak to the people for 3 nights, being sound. So he came out to his people from the prayer chamber, and signaled to them to exalt Allah in the morning and afternoon. Allah said, O John, take the scripture with determination. And we gave him judgment while yet a boy, and affection from us and purity, and he was fearing of Allah, and dutiful to his parents, and he was not a disobedient tyrant. And peace be upon him the day he was born, and the day he dies, and the day he is raised alive. And mention, O Muhammad, in the book, the story of Mary, when she withdrew from her family to a place toward the east. And she took, in seclusion from them, a screen. Then we sent to her our angel, and he represented himself to her as a well-proportioned man. She said, Indeed, I seek refuge in the Most Merciful from you. So leave me, if you should be fearing of Allah. He said, I am only the messenger of your Lord, to give you news of a pure boy. She said, How can I have a boy while no man has touched me and I have not been unchaste? He said, Thus it will be. Your Lord says, It is easy for me, and we will make him a sign to the people and a mercy from us, and it is a matter already decreed. So she conceived him, and she withdrew with him to a remote place, and the pains of childbirth drove her to the trunk of a palm tree. She said, Oh, I wish I had died before this and was in oblivion, forgotten. But he called her from below her, Do not grieve, your Lord has provided beneath you a stream, and shake toward you the trunk of the palm tree. It will drop upon you ripe, fresh dates. So eat and drink and be contented. And if you see from among humanity anyone, say, Indeed, I have vowed to the Most Merciful abstention. So I will not speak today to any man. Then she brought him to her people, carrying him. They said, O Mary, you have certainly done a thing unprecedented. O sister of Aaron, your father was not a man of evil, nor was your mother unchaste. So she pointed to him. They said, How can we speak to one who is in the cradle a child? Jesus said, Indeed, I am the servant of Allah. He has given me the scripture and made me a prophet, and he has made me blessed wherever I am, and has enjoined upon me prayer and zakah as long as I remain alive, and made me dutiful to my mother, and he has not made me a wretched tyrant. And peace is on me the day I was born, and the day I will die, and the day I am raised alive. That is Jesus, the Son of Mary, the word of truth about which they are in dispute. It is not befitting for Allah to take a son. Exalted is He. When He decrees an affair, He only says to it, Be, and it is. Jesus said, And indeed, Allah is my Lord and your Lord, so worship Him. That is a straight path. Then the factions differed concerning Jesus from among them. So woe to those who disbelieved, from a scene of a tremendous day. How clearly they will hear and see the day they come to us. But the wrongdoers today are in clear error. And warn them, O Muhammad, of the day of regret, when the matter will be concluded. And yet, they are in a state of heedlessness, and they do not believe. Indeed, it is we who will inherit the earth and whoever is on it, and to us they will be returned. And mention in the book the story of Abraham. Indeed, he was a man of truth and a prophet. Mention when he said to his father, O my father, why do you worship that which does not hear and does not see and will not benefit you at all? O my father, indeed there has come to me of knowledge that which has not come to you. So follow me. I will guide you to an even path. O my father, do not worship Satan. Indeed, Satan has ever been, to the most merciful, disobedient. O my father, indeed, I fear that there will touch you a punishment from the most merciful, so you would be to Satan a companion in hellfire. His father said, Have you no desire for my gods, O Abraham? If you do not desist, I will surely stone you. So avoid me a prolonged time. Abraham said, Peace will be upon you. I will ask forgiveness for you of my Lord. Indeed, He is ever gracious to me. And I will leave you and those you invoke other than Allah, and will invoke my Lord. I expect that I will not be in invocation to my Lord unhappy. So when he had left them and those they worshipped other than Allah, we gave him Isaac and Jacob. And each of them we made a prophet, and we gave them of our mercy, and we made for them a reputation of high honor. And mention in the book Moses. Indeed, he was chosen, and he was a messenger and a prophet. And we called him from the side of the mount at his right, and brought him near, confiding to him. And we gave him out of our mercy his brother Aaron as a prophet. And mention in the book Ishmael. Indeed, he was true to his promise, and he was a messenger and a prophet. And he used to enjoin on his people prayer and zakah, and was to his Lord pleasing. And mention in the book Idris. Indeed, he was a man of truth and a prophet, and we raised him to a high station. Those were the ones upon whom Allah bestowed favor from among the prophets of the descendants of Adam, and of those we carried in the ship with Noah, and of the descendants of Abraham and Israel, and of those whom we guided and chose. When the verses of the Most Merciful were recited to them, they fell in prostration and weeping. But there came after them successors who neglected prayer and pursued desires, so they are going to meet evil. Except those who repent, believe, and do righteousness, for those will enter paradise and will not be wronged at all. Therein are gardens of perpetual residence, which the Most Merciful has promised His servants in the unseen. Indeed, His promise has ever been coming. They will not hear therein any ill speech, only greetings of peace, and they will have their provision therein, morning and afternoon. That is paradise, which we give as inheritance to those of our servants who were fearing of Allah. Gabriel said, And we angels descend not except by the order of your Lord. To Him belongs that before us and that behind us and what is in between, and never is your Lord forgetful. Lord of the heavens and the earth and whatever is between them, so worship Him and have patience for His worship. Do you know of any similarity to Him? And the disbeliever says, When I have died, am I going to be brought forth alive? Does man not remember that we created him before, while he was nothing? So by your Lord, we will surely gather them and the devils, then we will bring them to be present around hell, upon their knees. Then we will surely extract from every sect those of them who were worst against the most merciful in insolence. Then surely it is we who are most knowing of those most worthy of burning therein. And there is none of you except he will come to it. This is upon your Lord an inevitability decreed. Then we will save those who feared Allah and leave the wrongdoers within it on their knees. And when our verses are recited to them as clear evidences, those who disbelieve say to those who believe, which of our two parties is best in position and best in association? And how many a generation have we destroyed before them who were better in possessions and outward appearance? Say, whoever is in error, let the Most Merciful extend for him an extension in wealth and time until, when they see that which they were promised, either punishment in this world or the hour of resurrection, they will come to know who is worst in position and weaker in soldiers. And Allah increases those who were guided in guidance, and the enduring good deeds are better to your Lord for reward and better for recourse. Then, have you seen he who disbelieved in our verses and said, I will surely be given wealth and children in the next life? Has he looked into the unseen, or has he taken from the Most Merciful a promise? No, we will record what he says, and extend for him from the punishment extensively. And we will inherit him in what he mentions, and he will come to us alone. And they have taken besides Allah false deities, that they would be for them a source of honor. No, those gods will deny their worship of them, and will be against them opponents on the day of judgment. Do you not see that we have sent the devils upon the disbelievers, inciting them to evil with constant incitement? So be not impatient over them. We only count out to them a limited number. On the day, we will gather the righteous to the Most Merciful as a delegation. None will have power of intercession except he who had taken from the Most Merciful a covenant. And they say, the Most Merciful has taken for himself a son. You have done an atrocious thing. The heavens almost rupture therefrom, and the earth splits open, and the mountains collapse in devastation, that they attribute to the Most Merciful a son. And it is not appropriate for the Most Merciful that he should take a son. There is no one in the heavens and earth but that he comes to the Most Merciful as a servant. He has enumerated them and counted them a full counting, and all of them are coming to him on the day of resurrection alone. Indeed, those who have believed and done righteous deeds, the Most Merciful will appoint for them affection. So, O Muhammad, we have only made the Quran easy in the Arabic language, that you may give good tidings thereby to the righteous and warn thereby a hostile people. And how many have we destroyed before them of generations? Do you perceive of them anyone, or hear from them a sound?
Next question over here.
Hi, yes. My name is Patrick. I'm a student at Centennial College. My question is, in Islam it says, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is not the Son of God. When we are all children of Allah and born of mother and father, for he is only born of a mother, why is he not the Son of God?
Brother Patrick asked a very good question, a very important question. He said that why in Islam is Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, not considered a Son of God? When we all are children of God, he being born of a virgin woman, all the more reason should be. See, brother, if you tell we are children of God, in that way I've got no problem at all. If you read the biblical language, if you say that we are children of God and Jesus is Son of God in that context, meaning he is person who follows the commandment of God most verily, all the messengers of God, they are sons of God. But the problem is, if someone says he is not a normal son, but he is the begotten son, then there's a problem. Because if you read the Bible have got sons, the God has got sons by the tons. If you read the Bible, Adam is son of God, Ephraim is son of God, Israel is son of God. It's mentioned in the book of Romans, chapter number 8. All those who are led by the Spirit of God, they are sons of God. That means if you follow the commandment of God, you're a son of God. I've got no problem with that phrase at all. But today, that phrase has been misunderstood. Now, for example, if a young son asked me a question, I said, Beta, son, it's a very good question. He won't mind because I'm elderly, you know. But if I say that begotten son, that means I'm insinuating him. You know, maybe he'll punch me. Fine. So what do you realize? That using the phrase son of God in the context that we are children of God, we have no problem. So in that context, all the human beings who follow the commandments of God can be called children of God. No problem. But what the Christian says, that no, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is not a normal son. And he quotes Gospel of John, chapter number 3, verse number 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, whosoever believeth in him shall not die but have everlasting life. Correct, brother? So do you believe Jesus is the begotten son of God?
I do.
You believe, fine. Now this verse which I quoted, Gospel of John, chapter number 3, verse number 16, it's from King James Version. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, whosoever believeth in him shall not die but have everlasting life. Now when you read the Revised Standard Version of the Bible, revised by Thaidu scholars, Christian scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 different cooperating Christian denominations, they say that this word begotten is an interpolation, it's a fabrication, it's a concoction, it's an adulteration. Who's saying? Not Muslims, not Hindus. Thaidu Christian scholars of the highest eminence in the Revised Standard Version of the Bible, they say begotten is an interpolation, it's a fabrication, it's a concoction, and they're throwing it out of the Bible. So if you say Jesus is son of God, like Adam, like Ephraim, like Israel, I have no problem. The moment you say begotten, I want to ask you the question, what is the meaning of begotten? Brother, what is the meaning of begotten? You know, begetting is an animal act. It's the function of lower animals of sex. And when you say that he was born to Mother Mary, virgin, what are you insinuating? And if you say, because Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is God, or son of God, because he was born to Mother Mary, Quran gives the reply in Surah Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 59. Inna masala Isa inda Allahi ka masala Adam. Khalaqa min turab. That when they say the similitude of Jesus in front of Allah is the same as Adam, they were born from dust and said be and it was. If you say that Jesus Christ is God because he had no father and only mother, then Adam, peace be upon him, is a greater God. He had no mother and no father according to the Bible. MashaAllah, you're clapping. I like it. So if you say Jesus is God because he had no father, only mother, Adam is a greater God, peace be upon him. He had no mother, he had no father.
I never referred to him as a God, but son of God.
That's right. Fine. So Adam is a bigger son of God. Right or wrong?
By your definition, Adam would be a God, for he has no mother nor no father.
Not my definition, not my definition. By the definition of the Christian missionaries, by my definition, he is a messenger of God. Because God cannot beget. I told you in my talk, Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begets not, nor is he begotten. The moment God begets, he is not God. Son of God meaning pious person, I agree. That is the reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, in 99 attributes, he has missed out Ab, father. Why? It's a good attribute. But Allah did not mention Ab meaning father because people started having wrong meaning of the word father. So he used the more difficult word, Rab, but did not use Ab. Logically, it's fine. But Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purposely did not use attribute Ab in the Quran because people will misunderstand. That's the reason English-wise, saying Jesus is the son of God, meaning messenger of God, I'm with you. But the moment you say begotten son, I have objection. So you say Jesus is a messenger of God, I say peace be upon him after his name. So I respect Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, more than you, Brother Patrick. Because when I take his name, I have to say peace be upon him. If I do not say that, I'm wrong. So I love Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, more than you. I follow his teaching more than you. And if you want, I can prove it to you.
That's a different argument, not for tonight.
Sorry?
That's a different argument and not for tonight.
Okay, fine. I'll give you a few things. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Fine. If you read the Bible, he was circumcised on the eighth day. Fine. Majority of all the Muslims are circumcised, the Christians aren't. So if you say Christian means a person who follows the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, then it's mentioned in the book of Leviticus, chapter number 11, verse number 7 to 8. It's mentioned in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 14, verse number 8, you should not have pork. It's mentioned in the book of Isaiah, chapter 65, verse number 2 to 5, should not have pork. Muslims don't have pork, most of the Christians have pork. If you read the book of Ephesians, chapter number 5, verse number 18, in the book of Proverbs, chapter number 20, verse number 1, it says you should not have alcohol. Muslims as a whole don't have alcohol, most of the Christians have alcohol. If you say Christian means a person who follows the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, we Muslims are more Christian than the Christians themselves. We love him. We respect him. If you say, I love Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, but don't follow his teachings, your love is false. We, therefore, mashallah, I love Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, more than most of the Christians. Because I follow his teachings, I respect him, I revere him. And Jesus Christ also said in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 11 to 14, I have many things to say unto you, but he cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He was talking about Prophet Muhammad to come. So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, you have to believe in the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So even that way, I'm following Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. I believe in Prophet Muhammad. Do you believe in Prophet Muhammad as the messenger of God?
I do.
MashaAllah. Now you're more closer to...
If you look at the history of Isa alayhi salam, his prophetic movement and his prophetic message was not fully implemented. A group of Bani Israel believed in him, but a group of them plotted with the Romans against his people, and eventually they were actually massacred and wiped out in 60 AD. And this is all, you can study this in the history. There were a group of early Christians called the Ebionites, and they were a Semitic Christian. They were Jewish people who had embraced the message of Isa alayhi salam. They were waiting for somebody to come after. And this is in their books. Fascinating information of the Dead Sea Scrolls. If you know about this, the Dead Sea Scrolls were some books that some poor Bedouin people found in the caves in Qumran, just outside near the Dead Sea. And they went and sold them to some Armenian traders. And the Armenians sold them to some Orthodox priests who sold them. They're all out for money. Everyone's trying to make more money. And they eventually got sold to the Catholic Church. The Nag Hammadi Library was a library that was discovered in 1947. The Nag Hammadi Library, within less than 3 years, was completely translated and published. Unlike the Dead Sea Scrolls, over 40 years have passed since they were discovered, and they have yet to be fully disclosed to the scholars. There have been major complaints by biblical scholars in universities all over the world that the Israeli government, in complicity with the Catholic Church, did not allow these manuscripts to be examined by scholars. And we have to ask why. Why is it that the Nag Hammadi library that was found in Egypt, which was actually a much larger volume of work, was translated within 3 years and published for the scholars all over the world to examine and look at, which included Apocrypha, it included the Gospel according to Thomas, it included the infancy Gospels, which confirm stories in the Quran that they did not have sources for. These people, the Dead Sea Scrolls, are part of a movement, some say from the Essenes, but there were a group of Christians that were Jewish people following the way of Isa and waiting for a prophet to come after Isa alayhi salam.
In biblical times, hundreds of scrolls and manuscripts circulated throughout the Holy Land. Tales that appeared to shed more light on many well-known biblical figures. Most were not included in the Hebrew or Christian Bibles. A little-known ancient text called The Life of Adam and Eve is one such writing, a forbidden book that tells a more detailed story of creation than the familiar tale found in the Old Testament. While its exclusion may be a mystery, we do know the book was popular in its day. The anonymous writer gave his ancient audience a chance to see these temptations from Eve's point of view. It is a surprising tale of deceit and betrayal, far different from the version found in Genesis. In The Life of Adam and Eve, Eve seems to be an innocent victim.
When Adam was created in God's image, the angels were ordered to bow to Adam or worship Adam, and Satan refused to do this. He said he should not bow to someone who was created after he was and who was inferior to him.
In defiance, Satan and his gang of rebel angels build a rival throne that literally places them above God. Outraged, God expels them from heaven and banishes them into the depths of the earth. This tale of Satan's jealousy and revenge is not found in the Holy Bible, yet it is among the stories told in the Quran, sacred scripture for Muslims, written 800 years later.
The Quran tells us that God creates human beings, Adam, out of clay, and that God creates these mysterious beings, jinn, out of what the Quran says is smokeless fire, fire without smoke. God calls Adam the greatest of his God's creations, and tells the angels to bow down before this creation. And one of them refuses. In the text of the Quran, Satan, Iblis, refuses to bow down.
Among those who studied the Book of Jubilees was a Jewish sect known as the Essenes. In 1947, a wandering shepherd stumbled upon their writings, tucked away in several caves overlooking the Dead Sea. This collection, lost for almost 2,000 years, became known worldwide as the Dead Sea Scrolls. Jubilees was among the documents that were found.
We have reason to think that they had run afoul of the authorities, particularly the high priest in Jerusalem, and that this group felt it had to go into a kind of exile. Maybe it was self-imposed, we don't know the details about it. But they used the Book of Jubilees. They may have been a persecuted group. They thought of themselves that way. But apparently these texts spoke to them.
Jubilees was a book that was never considered for canonization by mainstream Christian leaders. Large portions of the Book of Enoch also were found among the Essene literature, hidden in the caves of Qumran, as part of the Dead Sea Scrolls. By the second century, the Jesus movement was coming of age. Still, without formal leadership or an officially designated text, Early Christians were hungry for any information about their Savior. Books that were to become the Gospels of Luke and Matthew offered some information about the birth of Jesus, but all four Gospels were virtually silent on his early years. But a book not included in the Bible does deal with the childhood of Jesus.
I, Thomas the Israelite, am reporting to you, all my non-Jewish brothers and sisters, to make known the extraordinary childhood deeds of our Lord Jesus Christ, what he did after his birth in my region. This is how it all started.
The earliest existing copy of the Infancy Gospel of Thomas is a document from the 6th century. But at least one clue suggests his book was in circulation as early as 185 AD. At that time, a prominent bishop said that the stories then circulating about Jesus as a boy were spurious and apocryphal. He may have been referring to the Infancy Gospel of Thomas. The book, written by an unknown author, begins with several disturbing miracle stories.
One miracle has him allegedly by the River Jordan, because there weren't many rivers for him to be at in that part of the world, where he was making little sparrows out of clay, clapped his hands, and he told the sparrows to fly away and to say, "Remember this of me."
Well, Jesus at this point has acquired something of a reputation for himself in the village, and so people come around and they say, "Now, why did you push him off, Jesus? You know, how could you have done such a thing?" And Jesus says, I didn't push him off. I had nothing to do with his death." And in fact, to provide some evidence of his innocence, Jesus raises his playmate from the dead, brings him back to life, and says, "Zenon, tell them, did I push you down?" And Zenon says, "No, Lord. You didn't have anything to do with my death."
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.
Although stories from the Infancy Gospel of Thomas are not part of the Christian canon, they are found in Islam's holy book, the Quran. The Christian Bible tells us that a young Jewish virgin named Mary was chosen by God to give birth to the Savior of the world, a virgin birth. The Bible gives little detail on Mary's life before or after Jesus is born. But more than a century before the New Testament was canonized, a manuscript bearing the unlikely name, the Protovangelion of James, was written. This book purports to offer those details of Mary's life missing from the Gospel stories. The Protovangelion begins with Mary's middle-aged parents, Joachim and his barren wife, Anna. For years, they prayed desperately for a miracle, asking God to grant them a child. It is when Anna finally gives up that prayer is answered.
"And behold, an angel of the Lord appeared, saying unto her, Anna, Anna, the Lord hath hearkened unto thy prayer, and thou shalt conceive and bear, and thy seed shall be spoken of in the whole world. And Anna said to her husband, Now I know the Lord has blessed me very greatly, for behold, she who is barren has conceived."
There is no trace of this apocryphal story to be found anywhere in the Christian canon. The Quran tells of Joseph and Mary's marriage, of Joseph's children by a former wife, and the virgin birth of Jesus.
There are lots of women who are mentioned, so-and-so's wife, so-and-so's daughter, the queen of such and such a place, but Mary's the only one that's mentioned by name. So she has a very important role in the Quran and for Muslims. The story of the Annunciation in the Gospel of Luke is almost exactly paralleled in the 19th chapter of the Quran. The fact that Mary is mentioned more by name in the Quran than the Bible, I don't think most Christians are aware of that. The fact that Muslims believe that Jesus was born of Mary, who's a virgin, that the virgin birth of Jesus is an article of faith for Muslims, and a similarity with Christians.
In 1945, the story goes, an Arab peasant was traveling through the desert of Egypt, and he tripped over these large jugs in which were codices, books, these 13 codices that tell these stories of Jesus, these stories of the early Christians that are very different from most of what's preserved in our Bibles.
الصلاة والسلام عليك عليك يا الصلاة والسلام عليك عليك يا الصلاة والسلام عليك عليك يا سيدي عليك يا عليك يا سيد الأولين والآخرين
upon a very close scrutiny of the alleged references to Muhammad in the Bible as a prophet, they absolutely have no relation to the prophet of Muhammad, nor prophesy his coming.
Muhammad is not mentioned in the Old Testament. Muhammad is not mentioned anywhere in Genesis to Revelation.
Muhammad is God's true messenger. That's a joke!
Lo, we inspire thee as we inspired Noah and the prophets after him, as we inspired Abraham and Ishmael and Isaac and Jacob and the tribes, and Jesus and Job and Jonah and Aaron and Solomon, and as we imparted unto David the Psalms.
The verse we've just heard is from chapter 4 of the Quran.
In the verse, God is affirming to humanity that Muhammad is indeed the recipient of a divine guidance, just as Noah, Abraham, and the rest of the prophets. However, some Christians and Jews today don't believe that Muhammad was a prophet and the covenant that God made with Abraham. And since the Quran is not their book of authority, in this video I'm going to show you that the book you're holding in your hands contains the name off the seal of prophethood, the Prophet Muhammad. As known, the Old Testament was preserved in the Hebrew language. In the fifth chapter of the Shir HaShirim, which is one of the five Megillot or sacred scrolls that are part of the Hebrew Bible, or for short the Song of Solomon, as Christians know it today. That chapter is discussing someone. Jews will say it is discussing Solomon, while Christians will say it is discussing Jesus. Considering this is the Songs of Solomon, it would seem logical that it is discussing Solomon. The verses, describing this mystery man, have the narrator's speech conjugated in the feminine, meaning it is a woman who is describing this man. So it is possible that it is one of Solomon's wives discussing her husband Solomon. However, Christians assert that Jesus is being discussed, and that the chapter is describing a man who was not yet alive at that point. A prophecy. In reading the English translation of Song of Songs 5:16, it finishes the description by saying, "He is altogether lovely, but what most people don't know is that the name of that man was given in the original Megillot." Here is verse 16, and how it is written in ancient Hebrew, before introducing the vowels, in the 8th century. From the Hebrew Bible, on scripturetext.com. Here is the word in question. This word is made of four letters.
Mem. Het. Mem. Dalet.
Now when reading the word as it is written in its original form, with no vowels, it can be read as Muhammad, which is the name of the Muslim prophet, or as Mamad with no A after the H. According to Ben Yehuda's Hebrew-English Dictionary, it is correctly pronounced as Muhammad, not Mamad. So how we're going to know for sure if it's pronounced as Muhammad, the Muslim prophet, or as Mamad, a random Hebrew word? The only way is to give the verse to a rabbi and say to him, "Please read." Here is the Song of Songs 5:16, and how it is read by a rabbi from a Hebrew Jewish site. Please notice, the im in Hebrew is a plural of respect.
Hiko mamtakim vechullo Muhammadim. זה דודי וזה רעי בנות ירושלים, חיקו ממתקים וכולו מחמד, 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 מחמדים, זה דודי וזה רעי בנות ירושלים. חיקו ממתקים וכולו מחמדים, זה דודי וזה רעי בנות ירושלים. חיקו ממתקים וכולו מחמד, 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 מחמדים, זה דודי וזה רעי בנות ירושלים.
Here there's the famous SDL translation tool, which includes a professional human translation as well as an online translation. We're going to copy our Hebrew word of the Song of Songs directly from the Jewish site. It's the same site where you can hear the rabbi reading the verse in Hebrew. All links are in the description, so we're going to copy the word and paste it and ask, please translate. Are they going to translate the meaning of the name of that person? As the Bible translators did. Which is the praised and the lovely one, or are they going to keep the name as it is? Well, see it yourself. Here is the World Lingo translator. The result is the same. It's Muhammad.
You have no right. You have no right to translate names of people.
Anybody. Your name should be retained.
Mr. Black is Mr. Black,
though he's white.
You have no right to translate names of people.
But they have been doing that. Muhammad Ibn, they translated as altogether lovely. But the word Muhammad is dead in the Hebrew language. The word Muhammad is dead in the Hebrew language.
I will tell you a story from my own personal experience. Years ago, I used to spend every Sunday afternoon in a place called Speaker's Corner. And in my years down there, I got to know a Jewish rabbi. He was a very nice man. He used to listen to me, and he was always very polite and talked about Islam in a very nice way. And one day, during one of our conversations, after some years, I thought that it was about time I should invite him to Islam. So I said to him, you know, my friend, we have been talking now for many years, and even you have admitted to me that Muhammad is a prophet. So why then do you not embrace Islam? He said to me, we Jews, we never change our religion. I said, but half of the rabbis of Medina became Muslim. He said, that is true, but still, we Jews never change our religion. I thought, what can I say to him? He looked at me and said, listen to me, my friend. God sent to us a prophet Moses, and we didn't even listen to him. Do you think we're going to listen to another prophet after him, from another tribe, from another people? When he said that, I had nothing left to say. He knew that Muhammad was a prophet. In fact, another rabbi also came up to me and he said to me, we know Muhammad is a prophet. And he quoted to me a passage from the Bible